they talk around some of the issues that she's been dealing with relating gender resilience and participation. So thank you, Doina. Mark,
Jane, for this introduction. Well, I would argue that I'm coming from a political design angle. And I will speak about co-production that has become a buzzword in this time of austerity. It calls for the necessity to engage citizens in self-providing services in a context in which public services have become inefficient and need reforming. And the welfare state is not there anymore to organize them. So pragmatically, co-production is currently seen as mainly an economic and social solution to this problem. But I understand it in a different way. I understand it as a shift in the power relations around services and production, and in the context of the city, as a political project which is rooted in Lefebvre's idea of social production of space. So it is not only about how to satisfy citizen needs, but also about citizen rights. And in this case, the rights to the city, not only the rights to occupy space in the city, but also to decide about how space is developed, managed, and used in the present and in the future. And in this context, of current environmental and economic crisis, our cities need to become more resilient, and this is a truly ambitious co-production project that needs to involve citizens, all citizens, I would say, but also a project that needs ideas, needs tools and spaces, time and agency, and I believe that it needs agents and activators. And my question, or our question as a practice, is can architects be such agents? What tools and means can be used at time of crisis and scarcity? How can progressive practices be initiated while acting locally and at a small scale? What are the challenges of such practices? I would say ethical challenges as well. How can civic processes of co-production can be reactivated and sustained, and by whom? So these are some questions that we ask with the practice Jane mentioned, Atelier d'architecture autogéré, which is a practice we set up 15 years ago. And most of our projects involve co-production of urban and architectural projects with inhabitants in different metropolitan neighborhoods, and maybe not any kind of neighborhoods. We were more or less targeting these areas, which are called euphemistically zone urbaine sensible, which are in fact areas of social deprivation. And it's not because there is more need in this area, but we will argue also that there is more potential for the kind of practice that we are doing. So we have started in the area we were living as both professionals, say architects and citizens, inhabitants of this area, and then in other areas importing somehow the knowledge and methodology that we acquired in the first project. And currently we are developing a new project in a suburban city in northwest of Paris. So this is mainly the project that I will speak about. This is the first project, which was a series of mobile and dismountable devices that help us to occupy space in time. So it was meant to be a temporary garden, and it became an ongoing temporary garden, being relocated by the citizens themselves now in different locations. This is another project which is about transforming an interstitial space that was underused or even misused, yeah, it was more like a garbage dump, into a sort of generator of public space and popular ecological activity. And the current project is much more ambitious. It's a framework for resilient urban regeneration based on citizen networks and locally closed circuits. In fact, we conceive it as a participative strategy based on local circuits that activate material, water, energy, waste, and food, immaterial like local skills, socio-economic, cultural, and self-building flows between key fields of activities. So these are the principles, and we imagine that networks can emerge from a series of existing urban facilities, everyday practices, and civic activities within the cycling distances. I mean, this is what will establish the local scale. Also, this will be based on existing activities, organizations, collaborations that exist in the area that could be just connected and that all of this will function through locally closed circuits in such a way that, for example, waste can be recycled locally, water can be also collected and used locally, and so on. Products can be used locally. So diverse economies and local creativity and also reskilling processes can be stimulated, and new ways of living and working together can emerge. And this is a bottom-up resilient regeneration strategy that wants to have citizens as stakeholders. I think it's a different model than the ones that exist, but with this model, we contacted different municipalities and we managed to convince the municipality of Colombe, a city of 82,000 inhabitants in the north of northwest of Paris, to become partner together with a number of organizations for a pilot project that we submitted to the European Commission, and we were successful with. And this was the start of a four-year project that was meant to implement this strategy that was somehow drawing on this quite amazing civic activity that existed in the area. I mean, 450 civic organizations are existing, which is quite a lot. But also a higher unemployment rate, which in fact means also that people have time, so quite a lot of people have time. So we have mapped these organizations, and we imagine three hubs that will somehow polarize different types of activities. And these hubs would, of course, create complementarities between fields of activities, will close circuits, and will involve a network of resident around facilities. And we have imagined one, which would be for urban agriculture. another for recycling, and another for cooperative housing, all having the same principles. So we were able to be quite precise in calculating the environmental impact, but also the social and economic impact of them. And we started to implement the first one, which was this hub for civic agriculture, pedagogy, and agriculture that consists in experimental micro farm, collective gardens, education and cultural facilities, place for transformation of food and a local mini market. Also showcasing a number of ecological devices. I think this was a very, very important standpoint to use architecture as a way of making visible this relation that otherwise would remain invisible. So to showcase this in the way the building and the organizational space was conceived. Of course, this was meant to establish a number of cities with the neighborhood and with the other hubs. We had a temporary lease for this that has been agreed with the municipality, knowing that the space was issued from demolition. And was a sort of reserve for further development, but there was no project on it. So it was a sort of long-term temporary lease. So we have started with a participative garden, which is, I would say, a tactical way of getting the neighborhood to buy into the project. And this is the facility that we built. With recycled material, partially. Very soon a lot of activities were generated around, different ways of dealing with food, cultivating it, processing it. These are the ecological devices that I was speaking about, like, the rainwater collector, that would provide water almost 100% for watering the garden, a compost heating device also. And with this idea of closing circuits also on in the project itself. And this is how it looks like after 2 years. Reciclab provides a number of equipment for recycling and reusing urban waste and transformation in eco-design products, the waste being collected locally and reused. We had also a temporary lease for to use a part of a street that was closed. And for us was very paradigmatic as a site, as it was the site of Padrosita, because there are sites that will occur in time, I think much more than today. Probably there will be many roads that will be closed, or the prospectus will be reduced. So these are examples of ways of using with new facilities, such urban solutions. So we had workshops at the ground floor, and offices and design offices for working spaces in the first floor. And of course, these are some of the products that the makers that are using the Reciclab produce. So this is a very important aspect of the project. In fact, the participative governance aspect. Rurban is not about sustainable development, but about about societal change and political and cultural reinvention, addressing issues of social and environmental justice, power and cultural difference, and concentrating on these spatial agencies and the pilot facilities that I mentioned, Rurban tries to supply tools and spaces that will manifest citizens' existing resilience initiatives and practices. So spatial design processes contribute to expressing ecological cycles in tangible way and help facilitate citizen experience of making and doing. And democratic governance principles are as such associated with concrete hands-on actions whose consequences are visible and measurable. So more than just adaption, resilience in this case is a catalyst for urban activation, innovation and creativity. So these are the type of activities that in fact supported the existence of and the implementation of the strategy, from repair cafes to students' workshops to forms of alternative economy, to kind of popular creativity, skill exchange, knowledge exchange. This was a very important, I think, aspect. Also, unlike other initiatives that deal exclusively with sustainability from a technological and environmental perspective, Rurban advocates change of culture, understood as a change in how we do things in order to change our future. So it proposes new collective practices that, in addition to ecological footprint reduction, contribute to reinventing proximity relationships based on solidarities, like ways of being that involve collective decision, sharing spaces, also grouping facilities, rules and principles of cohabitation. And in neoliberal societies, urban lifestyles have progressively abandoned various forms of solidarity that were perceived as inadequate or outdated. And these relationships of reciprocity that we propose constitute the very basis of social progress. Maurizio Lazzarato, for example, in his analysis of connection between economy and politics, describes the civilizational process of progress as a constantly renewed effort to replace reciprocal possession with unilateral possession. It is precisely these relationships of reciprocity and solidarity that are missing from today's urban environment. The models proposed by Rurban aim at restoring these solidarity relations through processes that implicitly produce sociability, shared spaces, common values, and affective relations. So these are initiatives that have arose, as for example, a Crazy Club, repair cafes, recycling workshop, eco-design, someone related to groups, someone related to individuals. They would all go in the same direction of a collective dynamic. In Abrosite, a local shop and a cafe merged, a series of skill sharing workshops, a farm market, providing a way of disseminating the products of the garden, also training sessions, mutual health, and I would say people themselves changed, took different positions, like Yvonne, who has started a compost, a world compost business, but also parallelly he set up a school of compost, training others and finding ways of funding the school. So he's training now people in not quality officers. Also, you know, Alan as a beekeeper, Catherine, started for many of them, it's the first time they have an initiative. So there are other early retired, unemployed. And I think this was a very, very important aspect of the project, because the transformation must occur at a micro scale with each individual, each subjectivity, and this is how a culture of resilience is constructed. Rob Hopkins puts it, resilience is not just an outer process, it is an inner one of becoming more flexible, robust, and skilled. And the culture of resilience includes processes of skilling, skill sharing, social network building, and mutual learning. And all these micro-social and micro-cultural practices are usually related to individual lifestyles and practices, prompt attention to detail, to singularities, and the capacity for creativity and innovation that operates at the level of everyday life. However, you know, there was a kind of macro scale effect of this micro project. And again, this is something that we had in mind when we proposed a strategy that can disseminate further. And we decided that the network would evolve gradually into a large scale civic movement. It kind of contains the ingredients for to be reproduced in other places, and these places will be connected. But recently, the newly elected municipality announced that a temporary parking will be built on the location of the AgroCité. And municipality, which was initially a partner in the process, positioned itself against the project. This is because a new municipality team was elected, so most of the people that were part of the team have left. And in fact, this is very much a sort of politician decision. In fact, we realized that you know, political interests are sometimes even stronger than ethics. You know, ethics in terms of the municipality being a partner in a project that has been signed with the European Commission, ethics also in terms of you know, ignoring completely a civic initiative, and this is what they propose or what they are fixing. AgroCité is just across the road of this new development. That will, for which they have obtained, you know, quite big amount of money, and this is what the mayor said, that these operations would involve a better quality of life in the area. I think this asks the question, you know, this is done for, of course, the citizen good, but who decides what is good for citizens? Who cares for who? Is what John Tronto suggested as a major political question, because it reveals hierarchies, dependencies, and exclusions. And in a representative democracy, it is the local government. But in this case, the current team were not elected by the inhabitants of this area. They were elected by more affluent areas in the city. And however, the big development program takes place in this area, which is a poorer area. And this is a business also, because, for example, the mayor's family is involved in construction and development business. They provide a temporary private parking, because some of the parking places will be displaced from the new development, and of course the best place to do it was on AgroCité that you know, posted a lot of European money. So Rurban was meant to provide a forum where local government can be a partner in the negotiation with citizens on what is good for them and for the future of the area, but we have imagined the urban caretaking could be co-produced, not by focusing on immediate needs of the present, which are mostly driven by private and individualistic interests, but by informing and educating people to formulate needs for the future and involving them in providing solutions collectively and emancipating, testing, and taking initiatives. So we think that there is a right to resilience, and we claim this is a civic right. Rurban creates the condition for this right of resilience to be exercised not only as a right to access and consume sustainability, which is provided by the remains of the welfare state or by private providers, but as a right to produce resilience, allowing citizens involvement in decision making and action. And I think this is a political ecology approach, which not just positively and intrinsically presupposed improved development dynamics, but also questions the processes that bring about social justice and inequitable urban environments. It's not also a big society project. It doesn't react directly to the onset of the financial crisis and is not embracing a program of economic resilience from which the state is absent. Such a program explicitly promotes the use of unpaid work to mask the disappearance of welfare structures and massive cuts in public services. The Rurban strategy does not relegate economic responsibility to citizens because the state is unable or unwilling to assume this, but claims the social and political right to question state power as to its role and responsibilities. And municipalities and public institutions should have been involved as equal partners in this strategy, assuming the roles of enablers, funders, and administrators, because it is not only to the inhabitants to change themselves by changing the city, as Harvey said, but also to the politicians and specialists, and ourselves as well, to currently to change as well. So this in reality is more difficult. The temporality of many of these institutions is regulated by periodic election, which have as consequence important changes in the institutions themselves. So a municipal team is in place only for 5 years, and this is not enough. I think this is not enough to change mentalities, to initiate new dynamics, and to see results. So how to secure longer temporalities to allow the emergence of new social and economic agencies that are based on alternative to the dominant social technical regime, and how to at the same time speed up, knowing that environmental change is not waiting. So this is the question we have now with Rurban, and it brings about the fact that co-creating, co-designing commons is a deeply political, ethical undertaking. Creating commons that are more than just gardens and claiming the right of community, I think it's at the same time a professional political challenge for architects.
Thank you so much, Doina, for talking us through that amazing project, especially given the terrible issues that have now come up with it. And I wonder if it's going to be possible to work with that right-wing municipality and shift their position and not have a temporary car park on top of your project. But, yeah, it did make me think throughout about how important your work's always been in using architecture as a tool for empowering people and shifting subjectivities rather than the other way around, where architecture tends to be the end point rather than the starting point for thinking about political change. And I did wonder how we could use some of the principles in your project within the university to try and change the use of university structures and the right to resilience within the university itself.